Well, the people are not here because of the weather, Bill. The people are here because the Word of God is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and of the joints and the marrow. It's a critic of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. All scriptures God breathed, it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, so that the man and woman of God may become mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Therefore, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Turn in the word of truth this morning to John chapter 1. And yes, this is a celebration of our Lord's birthday. Yes, he was not born December 24th. That's another whole story. He's basically born sometime in April. But we're bringing into remembrance his birth, right? So it doesn't matter that what day he was really born, because we'd be worshiping the day if we did. What matters is that he was born. Amen? And that he became a man so that he could give us the greatest Christmas present we would ever have, which is himself. Because he paid the price for every single sin, past, present, and future, for any sin that we would ever commit, whether it's mental, sins of the tongue, or overt sins. Well, last time we began with the look at the subject that don't seem to be too edifying, but it is, and it's called the ugliness or the evil that's found in the first Christmas. Think of it with me for a moment, that first Christmas, a little review so that we can pick up where we are. But remember what took place at the first Christmas, which should have been a great celebration. I mean, think of all the people and what they're celebrating here today or what they're celebrating throughout the world today. Most of them are celebrating Santa rather than the Lord. But the real meaning is being neglected today. Why is it being neglected? Because people are still blinded from the fact that God sent his son. Last time we began to look at that, when he sent the son, there was a lot of ugly things, ugly events that also took place. Look at John 1:9. There was the true light. There was the true light. John is speaking of the true light. John the Baptist is talking, by the way, or John is talking about John the Baptist and the Lord Jesus Christ in context. And he says, there was the true light which cometh into the world. That's the Lord, who enlightens who? Every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. And here's the sad thing about the first Christmas. Think about it. Even though it's sad today that most Christians today, even children today, focus in on Santa rather than the Lord. Why? Because Satan has blinded their eyes. And so John 1:10 says this, he was in the world and the world was made through him and the world did not know him. And here's the sad event, one of the saddest events of the first Christmas, the ugliness that was behind it. Not the fact that he was ugly or he did an ugly thing, but the fact that a lot of ugly things were being done to him behind the scenes. You understand? Yet he endured. And one of the reasons why he endured, you know why he endured? Look right, look right, look left, look in front, look in back. All right, take. That's why he endured. That's right. That's why he endured. He endured. Why? Because of you. You and I were the joy that was set before him. Don't ever forget that. We're all precious in God's sight. Don't ever forget that. When we forget that, we forget the fact that God gave us the greatest thing heaven had to offer, called his unspeakable gift. 2 Corinthians 9:15 says words cannot even express who he is and what he's done for us, and that we are what he is. He is what he made himself to be through grace and through the principles of following perfect obedience, but he passed down that righteousness to us. And yet, even though he did all of that, and the first Christmas was the beginning of that, we read in John 1:11 that he came to his own, in context, his own here, of course, are the Jews, and those who were his own did not receive him. Now, I told you last week, I suppose that most people, when they think of this time of the year, they always think of the beauty of it. And we're surrounded by that beauty, the lovely trees, the bright lights, the decorations, the colorful ornaments, the candles, all the stuff that we see for Christmas that seems to be, you know, beautiful, and let your sins be like scarlet, though they're as white as snow, I'm going to cover them. And you know, we don't focus in on the spiritual aspect. We focus in on the natural aspect. We forget that the significance behind Christmas should focus in on one thing and one thing only, and that is the person of Jesus Christ. It's who and what he is and not who and what we are. So you see, all these lovely things we see, they're fine. But remember, there's an evil behind all of these things, the commercialization. And what seems to be overlooked is the fact that there is an ugly side of Christmas. In fact, I was doing some study on this because I was kind of shocked. Do you know where the word Christmas came from? Anyone? Santa?
No, you're
saying what they said they were. No, I'm talking about the word itself. The word itself is interesting because it's made up of two words, Christ and Mass. It's a Roman Catholic word. It's not a Presbyterian word. It's not a Baptist word. We don't follow that. Christ, they say it's Christ and it's Mass. Why do they say Mass? Because every Sunday, what do the priests do? A Mass, and they crucified that mat, that person. So when they first started, the word Christmas was dig up Christ and celebrate the fact that he did die, but we have to keep on putting him to death every week. So that's why the Roman Catholic Church said, come to confession on Saturday so that you could be clean on Sunday to receive Jesus that Sunday morning. And now you're celebrating the Christmas. That's where Christmas came from. Well, you can give me a nice round of applause. As you know, I don't get up that much right now. But that's interesting. There's a lot of ways we could approach this. Again, I want you to think about the following principles. We could talk about a dark, cold night in that small village in Palestine where that woman who was blessed among women, not above women, Luke 1:47, among women, gave birth to that baby in the most unsanitary, wretched conditions imaginable, standing in the filth of manure of a stable, totally surrounded by things that are unimaginable for us to even think that a child would be placed in such a surroundings. Look at Luke chapter 2. The ugly side of Christmas is going to be brought up, but it's going to be followed by the beauty and the glory of what God did. So bear with me. I'm going to keep you as long as I have to. This is the Lord's Day. It's his birthday. Come on. We can celebrate and go a little bit extra if we have to. Luke 2:6. Don't worry. I'll get you out in time for your Christmas presents. Luke 2:6. It came about that while they were there, the days were completed for Mary to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son. Now, notice we don't see it in the English as we see it in the original. And she wrapped him in clothes. Not clothes, swaddling clothes. Clothes used to bury the dead. You'd wrap up the dead bodies. And so she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in clothes and laid him in a manger, a gross place to lay. It's not the beautiful mangers that we see today in front of the churches. This was just made quickly, probably out of whatever leftover wood they could find that had not been burnt. Totally unsanitary, urine everywhere, manure everywhere, animals everywhere, and no one to welcome the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. They forgot the first Christmas. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in clothes, and here's a part of the ugliness of Christmas. She wrapped him in a manger. He should have been given the highest form of authority and the highest form of glory in the universe, which he will be given, but that will be in God's time. She laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the end. So notice the unsanitary conditions of our Lord's birth. We can also talk about the ugliness of a man named Herod, who, because he feared the loss of his control and power, he massacred all the babies in that region. Can you imagine killing babies 12 years and younger? All male species, by the way. Look at Matthew 2, so that you can get these down in your notes so I can lead you to where we're going with this. It's quite interesting. Matthew 2:7. Then Herod secretly called the Magi. Notice he did it secretly because he's a wicked man, Herod is. He has one thing in mind. He wants to be the king. And so he said, Herod secretly called the Magi. These are the over 40 wise men, not three. He ascertained from them the time that the star appeared. They had been following that star. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and make careful search for the child. And when you have found him, report to me that I may come and worship him. Last Sunday morning, remember? That's a lie. having heard of the king, they went their way, and lo, the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over where the child was. And when they saw the star, notice this is glory here, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. They came into the house and they saw the child with Mary his mother. They fell down and worshipped him. That's a nice part there. Opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, why? Because Herod had ordered the execution of all those children. Think about it. On the first Christmas, all you could hear was Lamentations talks about it. Jeremiah wrote it, by the way. All you could hear was baby mothers screaming and wailing and crying because their babies were being taken from them. First, they'd see whether or not it was a male or a female. If it was a male, you'd kill it right on the spot, 2 years and younger. Ugliness of Christmas. We could also talk about not just that, but let's say the spiritual realm. We could talk about the indifferent population. You know, there's actually people that can't go to church this morning and they can't go to church tonight at Christmas Eve or Christmas Day because they're too busy celebrating the holidays. Talk about hypocrisy. I mean, I know it's weird, and I know it's not deep or anything, but I think God just has a really good sense of humor when he says about the Christmas holiday, hello, how dumb can you be? Put the words together. There is Satan. And what else is there?
Santa.
There is Satan and there is Santa. That's where we get Santa from. And of course, it may be true. I don't know. God, in the sense of humor, maybe he tied one on one day, said, I'm really going to screw them up. You know, he has to have fun too, you know. He's God. He invented everything, so he can do anything because he's got control over everything. He's not like us, or me anyway, or like some of us. I have to include you in that too. So we could talk about that, the indifferent population that could care less. Who could care less that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, had been born in their midst? Have you? Can you? Do you? You say, well, I don't celebrate Christmas. What's so wrong with it? By the way, the Bible says every day is the day of the Lord. So every day is really a Christmas. There's something beyond these things, something lurking behind every beautiful scene on every Christmas card, every loving sentiment of Christmas. Somewhere behind there's some form of evil in view to take us away from the doctrine of the hypostatic union, which is the fact that God became a man. And without understanding that, there's no way you can have salvation because there's no other name whereby men can be saved except by the name of Jesus, says Acts 4, verse 12. Merry Christmas. The most wretched, heinous, and hideous reality in the universe was taking place during that first Christmas. And there's the dark and ugly side of Christmas is filled with two types of things, sin and evil. However, and here's where I want to make my turn now. I want you to turn now to John chapter 3 for a moment again. John, the third chapter. The heart of Christmas is this. Christ came into the world to save sinners. He was manifest to take away sin. Shall call his name Jesus. That's why he came, to save people from their sin. It's beautiful, magnificent, and glorious what he went through, but what it cost is beyond human description. Ugly, but glorious. You don't think God, God the Father, who does have emotion, you don't think that he actually went through a form of pain and suffering when he heard his son cry out, Father, help me. Eli, Eli, my God, I can understand why they are all forsaking me, but not you. Can you imagine what he went through? It was ugly, but it ended up glorious. That's where the balance comes in. The real beauty of Christmas is to understand that the ugliness that is incurred all during the birth, and by the way, we'll see in just a moment, during his lifetime, leaving us with the Christmas gifts called his promises, because that's where we're going. When that happens, I just gave you a hint of something that's coming up that's going to be great. When that happens, then you're going to see something fantastic. You're going to see the fact that individuals are going to recognize the importance of the doctrine of the hypostatic union, that God became a man and that I can become a new creature in Christ. And these are just one of the many, many gifts God has given us, over 40 on the day that we were saved. He constantly pours himself out upon us. And what does he ask in return? A little love? a little respect. You've been created for one reason, which is to do what? To give glory to him. So have I. What are we waiting for? 2018, it's the new year. I believe it's going to be a record year because I believe a lot of cataclysmic events are going to take place. But we'll see what happens. But I'd say be ready. So we could also see, this is my concern today, to demonstrate the power of the sin nature, you see? To demonstrate the power of the sin nature, to demonstrate the power of Christ living and dying and rising again, and to deal with that which robs us all of human life. That's why we are here, right there, to demonstrate the power of the sin nature. The sin nature was demonstrated during the first Christmas. He went through all of that because of our sin nature. He demonstrated the power of how he lived. He lived with the power of the Spirit, the power of God. He lived in that living, dying, and rising. And that's what robs us of human life when we do not do that which he said to do. What is that great sin? Last Sunday morning's message. Remember where we closed? What is it?
Unbelief.
The sin of unbelief. Good there. Good there, buddy. This is my Walmart friend, Bob. Hey, Bob, how you doing, buddy? You look different with your glasses and your stash. Good to see you. I got him saved. What time did I get you saved in the morning at Walmart? What was it?
You came until like 2:30,
3 o'clock in the morning?
Yes. I worked from 11 to 7.
I came into your life. There I was, 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning. I said, do you know where the Pampers are? Thank you. I gave you books, yeah? And here you are. And this is not your first time. You've been with us over a year now, I think.
Yep.
Good. Name is Bob from Walmart. Just call Bob from Walmart. I know you're not there no more. What?
I left.
Okay, you're at another place. All right, tell my son-in-law John that after service so he knows what you do. Okay, let's go. John 3:18. Here it is again. What is the great phenomena that damns every soul to hell? The problem is unbelief. And that's why in salvation, but the same thing happens after salvation. We can still not be a believer after we're saved. What do I mean by that? We lack the ability to believe what God's word says. We're still going to heaven. We're still children, but we're being blinded by the God of this world. That's why 2 Corinthians 4:4 tells us that. So when it says, he who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe has been judged already because he has not what? He has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. You see, because of unbelief and sin, because of the fact that we are unbelievers and we don't believe God after we're saved at times with all the promises and gifts he's given us, because of unbelief and sin, there's tears, there's pain, there's wars, there's fighting, there's anxiety, there's discord, there's unrest, there's fear, worry, sickness, death, famine, earthquakes, and pollution. The result of what? All was a result of man's fall. Man's sin nature being spread throughout the entire world. We produced this as creatures against God. We did it. We produce our own tears and pain, wars and fighting and anxiety. All of this is because we don't believe what God did about setting us free from that damn old sin nature. All these things are going to try to destroy your life and get you sidetracked and take you away from the plan of God. And that's why I gave you in closing last Sunday with the fact that so many people have a problem. The problem for many is that we are much more prone to excuse our sin than they are to examine it. See, we want to excuse the fact that we did something rather than say, this is why I did it, and I'm going to try not to do it again. I may do it again, but you know what? So what? I'm going to keep picking up the pieces and going forward. Remember, Proverbs 28:13, he who conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will find what from God? Compassion. It's not just naming and citing. It's not just confessing. It's also getting out of that particular situation that's dragging you down. Confesses and forsakes will find compassion. Now turn to Isaiah chapter 14. Moving right along. All of this is to show you that it's fitting at this time of the year when men would cover their sin with all the beauty of Christmas being, you know, think of all the beauty of Christmas now. Everybody looks at the good part of the person. And they bygones be bygones. A lot of forgiveness goes on. And it's good at times. But there's also a lot of hypocrisy, isn't there? Remember, when one day they asked the Lord, where's your family? And he said, here's my family. Those who hear the word of God and keep it. It was a shocking statement. And so you, when until the day that ugliness manifested its ugly head, from that day on, it still exists today in all realms. But where did it begin, and what was the main reason that it continued? That's what I want to bring up, the ugliness of man's independence toward God. Remember that the ugliness of man's independence from God, where did it come from? It came from Satan. Look at Isaiah 14, 12. How you have fallen from heaven, O star of the morning. Notice he was once an angel, and an angel who was a star among the other angels. He had a place of authority in the heavens. Yet he had something that bothered him. He didn't want to be number two any longer. He wanted to be number one. He wasn't happy with who God had made him to be. How you have fallen from heaven, O star of the morning, son of the dawn. You have been cut down to the earth, you who have weakened the nations. Satan's the one who destroys nations. And here's why. You said in your heart, here's your thinking, I what? I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like what? The Most High. Independence. Independence is revealed by the ugliness of the believer who does not live in the victory of the cross. They say, I don't need God. That's where independence comes in. I don't need God. I don't need to do things God's way. I've got my own life with God. I'm doing my thing. I'm doing things my own way. Independence is revealed when you're so ugly that you think you've got a victory. And how great is that darkness when you think you're in the what? Light. You think you're in the light. So independence is revealed by the ugliness of a believer who says, I am a rock. I am an island. I don't need anyone. I don't need a local assembly. I don't need a church. I don't need people. I don't need anything at all. I just got, it's just me and Jesus. Ha, but you got a problem. Because the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't call him Jesus here. We give him the authority and we give him the respect he should. That's why we call him the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord Jesus Christ is the reason why we are here. Amen? He's the reason why we are here. And when we recognize that, when then we look at our life and say, we've been created for this one reason. Why would I enter into independence when Satan is the prototype of what happens to a creature that goes against God's plan? The reason Christ was born, therefore, was to deal not just with sin, but the entire sin nature. Because there's a good part of the sin nature called evil. And that's where it does things that it wants to do, like say you're going out with your family for dinner, okay? Nothing wrong with that. You're going out with your family for dinner. Now, for some person, that's okay. For another person, it's wrong. Why? The other person had a previous commitment, or the other person made a vow or made a decision to do something. So sometimes you have to recognize that when people make certain decisions like that, that their sin nature might be operating in the good part. The sin nature might be doing, helping a little old lady cross the street or going shopping for someone, doing something good. But if that thing that you're doing is good takes you away from the plan of God, then that thing that is good becomes what? Becomes wrong. It becomes evil. So when Christ died, he died for sins, but he also died for the entire sin nature. Now, Christ died for sins. Sins have been judged. Amen? What will be judged after sin? Anything? Who knows? Your works. Okay, you got it. So when will the good part of the old sin nature be dealt with? That will be dealt with at the judgment seat when we stand before God and God says, okay, let's evaluate all your works. And it says, your works were good, but they weren't perfect, so I have to reject them. They weren't good enough to get blessing with God. You have to either do it the power of God in God's way or you can't do it at all. And so, you see, independence is revealed when you say you want to do it your way and you don't live in the victory of the cross. That's the seeming contradiction of the cross. There's so much glory to it, but there's so much ugliness to it as well. In fact, that's why the cross is referred to as a tree. It's referred to as a tree at times, as in Deuteronomy 21, 23. 1 Peter 2:24, talking about he died on that tree. So sometimes it's referred to as a tree. If there were no sin, there would need to be no Christmas. Think about that. Do we say, shall I sin that Christmas may abound? No. But that's what sin did. It brought the fact that mankind, you need a savior. And boys, I told you before, If God said you can do two ways, you can be born perfect, and as you turn out with your own perfect decisions, you can stand before me, or you can be born condemned and follow another, and because he's perfect, I'll give you his righteousness. You'd be stupid to choose you, right?
Yes.
You don't want to say, oh, I'm going to depend upon myself. You say, no, I'm sick, whole head sick, whole heart is faint. Nope, I'm out of here. Why? Because I want to trust in him. He's the reason for the season, as we say. So, the sin nature must come to the forefront. It is that which generates what we call cosmic chaos. You see, the Bible says, for example, when the Bible says the wages of sin is death, there's two types of death there. Spiritual death, separation from God, all unbelievers. But temporal death is when believers are not filled with the Spirit. But whatever it is, the wages are the results of that sin nature. It doesn't say sins, does it? It's not talking about personal sins. It's talking about the entire sin nature. The wages of the good part of your life, your good sin nature, produces what? Death. And every person ever born will die either once or twice. Remember, born twice, you die what? Once. Born twice, you have a physical birth. Spiritual birth, you only have one death. Your physical death, or absent from the body rapture exception. And then at the other way, if you're born once and you die twice, now what? You're an unbeliever. So I think you want the first one, don't you?
Yes,
amen to that. The greatest gift God gave us is where the Bible says that Jesus Christ came into the world to save us, not from sins only, but Merry Christmas, from the entire sin nature. That is a blessing, isn't it? The entire sin nature. That's the reason for his coming. That's a part of the ugliness of Christmas. In the first Christmas, sin was dealt with. Sin was the issue when he came in the first Christmas. In the second Christmas, at the second coming, the Lord's going to judge us. Our Lord God will be glorified, and the bad part of the old sin nature will be judged as well. So it is the main reason for Christmas. It's the reason that we are here. It's the degenerative power that we have to face, because every broken marriage, disrupted home, shattered friendship, argument, disagreement, evil thought, evil word, evil deed, good deed, undone, all can be attributed to the old sin nature. And by that, you don't want to get involved in that type of bondage. That's why in Joshua 7:13, sin is called an accursed thing, or that which is banned. Sin, God doesn't say don't sin because he doesn't want us to have any fun. He says, don't do it because you'll be under a curse. It's compared to scripture, the scripture of venom. It says that sin is like having venom come out of your mouth toward people and toward your loved ones, but eventually even toward yourself. And anything that is that sinister and that powerful and totally debilitating for the whole human race has to be dealt with by someone. Who? God. It has to be dealt with by God, who is infinitely holy, to bring man to himself. So the Christ had to come. You cannot look at Christmas without being reminded almost everywhere about its beauty and glory, but also the cost. Don't just say, isn't that beautiful? The child was born. How about he was born to die? And he had to live his life for 3 years. Under the scrutiny of the Pharisees, that precious day when his life was under attack. His life was under attack by the kingdom of darkness constantly, and he did not quit. That's why he did not quit. Yeah, give him a nice round of applause. That's why we have a few things that were said about him. Go to Matthew chapter 9. I've still got some time, so bear with me. Oh, by the way, I went to the doctors. I want to tell you what happened. They wanted to give me an MRI on Wednesday. I ended up one on Thursday because I don't like the closed one. So I had the open one. So they checked to see if I got a problem with my shoulder. Looking at the shoulder, the cuff, if it's the cuff that's hurt, or it might even be the collarbone. I'm not sure. Keep it in prayer, but I feel I can teach right now. It's just hard to study. So just keep me in prayer because you're doing a good job. I start to feel a little bit better even this morning. Thank you very much. Now, I believe there are two reasons why the Lord endured after he was born. I believe there are two reasons he endured after the first Christmas. Number one, here's how he lived. Not my will, but your will be done. Remember what we read last Sunday in Hebrews 10? He said, I came into the world, and he said, a body have you prepared for me? You recall that? And he said, a body have you prepared for me? And then he says, I came to do what? Your will. Your will. I came to do that. Very good, Bob. I came to do my Father's will. So he says, this two reasons why he endured. One, the Father, not my will, but thy will be done. Two, you and I were the joy that was set before him. And because of the ugliness of sin and evil, once our Lord was born, he continued to receive ugliness from man. Do you realize that? It didn't stop at birth. At birth, we have maybe 12 years that were unrecorded, and maybe up to age 12, we don't hear about Jesus till about 33 after, or 30 after that. But we don't know. All we know is that the ugliness of sin and evil continued during his life. Once he was born, he continued to receive the ugliness from Satan, the ugliness from the unbelievers, the ugliness from the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and his own people, his own family turned on him. The ugliness of the presence of the old sin nature at that first Christmas continued until our Lord finally arrived at that ultimate Christmas tree we call a cross, which I won't have time to go into. I'll continue and do my closing message on this. I'm going to close it next Sunday and cut out that. That'll be my last message of 2017, right? Yeah. 2018's coming up. How many are happy about the new year? Come on. Excited. Another year God has given us. So think about it. As a child, our Lord had to be protected by his parents. For 12 years, they had to protect him. Then he grew up, and the Bible says he kept on. Well, look at Luke. You're in Matthew, right? Look at Luke 2:40 for a moment. Because people wonder what happened to Jesus during those unrecorded years. We only know a few things. But I think Luke 2:40 says the child, notice he's called the child in Luke 2:40. The child continued to grow and become what? Strong. Notice he continued to grow. This is not just physical growth. This is mental growth. He became strong, increasing in wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Verse 52, and Jesus kept increasing in what? In wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and with men. You think about it. He kept on increasing. Why? Because of the battle that was being set before him. Because of what he was about to endure. Go back to Matthew chapter 9. Think about it. As a child, our Lord had to be protected by his parents, not only at birth, but during those early years. And then we don't know what happened to him up to age 30. Some people believe he was down in India somewhere, but I have no information that can guarantee that that's true. But I want you to see what they said about him in Matthew 9:34. It says our Lord was of the who? Are you in Matthew 9:34? Does it say our Lord was of the devil? Yeah. Well, say it. When I say that our Lord was of the what? The devil. He cast out the demons. Oh, yours says demons? Yeah. Okay, I got it. Mine says devil. He cast out the demons by the ruler of the demons. Demons are good. And that's what they said about him. Look at Matthew 11:19. They said he was a glutton. Oh, he's a glutton. He is a drunk. He hangs out with prostitutes, the wild crowd. He's not friends with those sinners. He's not holy. Watch out for him. The Son of Man came eating, he says, and came drinking. And they said that our Lord was a glutton, that he was a drunk and hung out with prostitutes. They said this. It says the Son of Man came eating and drinking. And they say, behold, he's a gluttonous man. He's eating fine food. It doesn't mean he wasn't supposed to eat. Eating fine food, drinking fine beverages. And they said, behold, he's a gluttonous man and a drunkard, a friend of tax gatherers and sinners. Did the evil and the ugliness continue that began at Christmas? Absolutely. Evil always attacks evil and even uses more evil to discipline evil. That's what the book of Revelation is all about, where God uses evil nations to discipline other evil nations, and the world ends up being self-destroyed. Look at Matthew 26:55. Notice what they said about this man. Remember, he kept on increasing in wisdom and in stature. He had doctrine down pat. And here's what they said about his doctrinal intake. Matthew 26:65, they said that he blasphemed. Then the high priest tore his robe, saying, he has blasphemed. What does it mean? He blasphemed God. He came against God. He blasphemed the Holy Spirit. He blasphemed the Father. And they accused him of doing all that. And in Matthew 26:66, look at the next verse. They said that he deserved to be what? Dead. Talk about ugliness. Here's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. They answered and said, he is deserving of death. In Matthew 3:21, our Lord was accused of being nuts and insane. Anyone ever do that to you? You got nuts, you know, twice a week church now? What are you, crazy? No. Look, Mark 3:21. What does it say? When his own people heard of this, they went out to take custody of him, for they were saying, he has lost his senses. Did the ugliness continue? Yes, it did. Mark 3:22. He's demon-possessed. Scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying he is possessed by Beelzebul. Mark 3:30, he has an unclean spirit. Luke 15:2, he had a reputation for hanging around with sinners. This man receives sinners and eats with them. Luke 23:2, it goes on to say, that was 15:2. 23:2, they accused him of being unpatriotic. They began to accuse him, saying, we found this man misleading our nation and forbidden to pay taxes to Caesar. What were they doing? They were trying to let the ugliness of Christmas to continue. Now, you know what the beautiful thing is? The beautiful thing is that you and I can stop that. We don't have to let the ugliness continue, do we? All we have to do is reveal to people the beauty and the glory of what it means to be an ambassador for Christ without them knowing that we're operating in it. Show them the love, give them the respect, and let them see that God so loved the world that he gave. And the most important thing that he gave was his uniquely born son. Thank God for his indescribable gift, Jesus Christ.
Genesis, he's the breath of life. In Exodus, the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he's our high priest. Numbers, fire by night. Deuteronomy, he's Moses' voice. In Joshua, he is salvation's choice. Judges, lawgiver, in Ruth, the kinsman redeemer. First and Second Samuel, our trusted prophet. In Kings and Chronicles, he's sovereign. Ezra, a true and faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of broken walls and lives. In Esther, he's Mordecai's courage. In Job, the timeless redeemer. In Psalms, he is our morning song. In Proverbs, wisdom's cry. Ecclesiastes, the time and season. In the Song of Solomon, he is the lover's dream. He is. He is. cry for Israel. Ezekiel, he's the call from sin, and Daniel, the stranger in the fire. In Hosea, he is forever faithful. In Joel, he is the Spirit's power. In Amos, the arms that carry us. In Obadiah, he's the Lord our Savior. In Jonah, he's the great missionary. In Micah, the promise of peace. In Nahum, he is our strength and our shield. In Habakkuk and Zephaniah, he's pleading for revival. In Haggai, he restores a lost heritage. In Zechariah, our fountain. In Malachi, he's the son of righteousness, rising with healing in his wings. He is, he is, he is. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he is God, man, Messiah. In the book of Acts, he is the fire from of God. In Corinthians, the power of love. In Galatians, he is freedom from the curse of sin. Ephesians, our glorious treasure. Philippians, the servant's heart. In Colossians, he's the Godhead Trinity. Thessalonians, Timothy, Titus, Philemon, he's our meat.